So now we are hearing some wisdom from Sweden, right? So Björn Ramel is a child and adolescent psychiatrist working in Malmö in child and adolescent psychiatric clinic at a unit that is treating refugee children traumatized by war and torture. And glad to have you here, Björn, and glad to hear about all the work you are doing there in Malmö.
Okay. Do you hear me? Yeah? Okay, so I switch to Finnish. No. But now you've just had lunch, so if you fall asleep, that's okay. But I will try to say something about the treatment of unaccompanied refugee minors. And thank you very much for the introduction and for the invitation here. And I called this presentation Shelter from the Storm. I don't know if that sounds familiar to you in any way. Any ideas? Shelter from the Storm? Well, I think you know the one who won the Nobel Prize in Literature last year, Bob Dylan. So this is actually a song from Bob Dylan, a song from his album called Blood on the Tracks. And Blood on the Tracks is a record about a divorce. But this song, Shelter from the Storm, is really a love song, I would say. But it actually also has some application, I think, to the situation about refugees. And you know, they say Bob Dylan has some prophetic capacities, and I think this is maybe shows that. So he says in this song, it starts, it was in another lifetime, one of toil and blood, when blackness was a virtue and the road was full of mud. I came in from the wilderness, a creature void of form. Come in, she said, I'll give you shelter from the storm. So, you know, the pictures that you showed, Mats, and with all the refugees traveling through Europe, I think that's, you know, all these refugees, they become just big numbers and not persons. So void of form is what I think of when I see sometimes these pictures. And our job is really to give them shelter from the storm. So this is to show you the number of unaccompanied minors applying for asylum in Sweden over the last 10 years. And as you can see, it's been a gradual increase with a peak last year. So unaccompanied minors is not a new phenomenon. It's very much a hot topic at the moment in many countries, and for obvious reasons, because there are many of them, but it's not a new historic phenomenon. We had, for instance, many unaccompanied minors coming from Finland to Sweden during the Second World War. And now, 2016, the numbers have decreased again, but I'll come back to that. I usually say last year, but now I have to say the 2 years ago, 2015, we had 160,000 refugees applying for asylum in Sweden. 70,000 of those were children, and out of those, 35,000 were unaccompanied minors, including 3,000 girls. So the majority were boys. And in a European perspective, there were 90,000 unaccompanied minors coming to Europe, and 40% of those choose to come to Sweden. So primarily males from Afghanistan. We have also minors from Iraq, from Syria, Somalia. And why Sweden? Yeah, I mean, there are probably a very different reasons for that, but I think one major reason is that there's already a large diaspora in Sweden, so in that sense it might be more natural going to Sweden rather than some other country. And at least in a historic perspective, I think Sweden has had a fairly good reception system comparatively, and also with favorable asylum laws. So over the last years, then for unaccompanied, so between 65% and 90% basically had received residency. And it used to be that these residencies were permanent. Speaking of the situation in Denmark where you had to apply again and again for to stay, but in Sweden it used to be that they received permanent residency. Now with this huge increase of refugees, the political climate has changed and also the laws. So first of all, the government implemented border controls, and then they changed the laws for asylum, so they became more strict. And now you can still receive a permanent residency in Sweden, but normally you receive a temporary asylum. This is if you're granted status as a refugee, you can actually, by the Geneva Convention, you can get a permanent residency still. And it's becoming more difficult to get family reunion. They've also changed the housing system for unaccompanied minors. So they've introduced a new type of housing with less care, less staff, for the adolescent minors, as supposed to be able to take care more of themselves. And this is, of course, to save money. And the public debate changed more harsh, and we've also seen attacks on housing for refugees. So the climate around refugees is changing. And then just the system as it is now, it's probably pretty similar to Finland, as we talked about. But everyone is appointed a legal guardian if you're unaccompanied minor, and also a lawyer to help in the asylum process. And the overall responsibility for the well-being of the unaccompanied minor is at the social services. And then they're placed in an initial, it's called transit housing, and then they're supposed to move to a municipality where they more permanently or for a longer period of time. And that place, the second after the transit housing, it's called hem för vård eller boende, home for care or housing. And they can be either public or private contractors, and they are normally like between 10 and 20 minors staying at these places, and they're staffed 24/7. And then the younger children are more often placed in foster care homes. And now then we have this new third type of housing that I just mentioned. Everyone has the right to school and health care, independent of legal status. So even during, as you're an asylum seeker, you have the right to school, you have the right to health care free of charge, just like any other child. And you talked about healthcare screening. That is in Sweden still offered. It's not mandatory, but it's offered, and by the primary care sector. And I think I'm not doing those kind of screenings. But from what I hear, it's more focused on actually infectious diseases. So it's in a sense, it's a way for us to protect ourselves from the disease that these refugees might bring to the country. But there are also some screening questions concerning mental health. I think they could be incredibly improved, because the healthcare problem is, I think, really a much larger problem than the infectious disease, not to diminish either of them, but anyway. And then medical age assessment is now rarely performed, but this is also something the government wants to change, because this is where Sweden has been the odd one out as well. I think in many other countries, age assessments, or just whether you want to call it assessments or not, but the authorities sort of judge what age the child has, and more or less arbitrarily. But these assessments, as we know them today, are unreliable, with a big difference, you know, so they're not really reliable. But now the government wants to implement a new system for having age assessment, and they've actually assigned the Swedish National Board of Welfare to come up with a new method, and that's what I hear. It's supposed to be an MR investigation of the knee joint, and also something with the tooth, and the combination of these should hopefully be a bit more reliable, but we don't know. And this is a tricky issue, I think, having age assessments or not. I think there are good arguments for not having, but there are really also good arguments to have them if they're reliable. And I think if they're not reliable, the doubt must be on the favor of the applicant. Yes, shortcomings, there are plenty of those. These are just some. Now, we have long asylum processes, so often more than 1 year that they have to wait. School start is delayed. The social services has been and probably still is overburdened. So being responsible for the overall well-being of the child, they really don't handle that thing very well, I would say. And a more general problem is that with the minors, there are different actors. You have the legal guardian, you have the social service, you have the housing, you have different actors, and responsibilities is sometimes quite unclear. And it must also be, I think, sometimes confusing for the child. Who is really deciding? Who is responsible for this? Who is responsible for that? And to make it more coherent for the child, I think it's important to have more cooperation. And also at times we have frequent relocation of the child. So they're moving from different places, different houses, not just because they're moving from transit to a municipality, but also if it's not working one place, they're, you know, acting out, they're externalizing behavior, violent, they move to different housing. And this can be, of course, very problematic, because it just adds to the instability and insecurity that for the child. And the staff working at these residences are, I think, also sometimes a problem, because they don't have the proper education or the knowledge about trauma, and what the consequences of traumas, and also a high turnover of the staff working there. So the other day I just had an encounter with one of these guys. He was actually a plumber, unemployed plumber, so now he worked at this place. I mean, he can be an excellent person, but he doesn't have the education, apparently. Okay, so turning 18 is also a critical period, because the rights and the support for those who are minors is, of course, better. So when they turn 18, they sometimes have to move to a different place. The legal guardian that they have is often taken away. The right to health care is again now more limited. Anyone over 18 is a right to health care that can't be postponed. So it's not just emergency cases that are treated, but it's actually a bit wider construct, and it's up to the individual doctor usually to decide, is this healthcare that can be postponed or cannot. So it's in a way flexible, and I think in general they're interpreted pretty liberal these laws. And yes, possibility for residency decreases. And also, from our perspective, when you're 18, you move up to adult psychiatry, and that's often a different story compared to being treated at the child and adolescent psychiatry. And if nothing else, I think the experience of these children is not as good in adult psychiatry. So now I've been speaking a lot about unaccompanied minors as if they are a sort of a heterogeneous group, and I think they're not. I mean, they come from different countries, different socioeconomic background. They come to different countries. They've stayed in the new country for different length of time. Their legal status is not the same. So it's hard to. I think it's not fair really to group them together because they're quite heterogeneous. And also looking at the literature, this is a problem because, you know, if you're doing an investigation, a study in the UK, the conditions might be quite different from Sweden on the same group, unaccompanied minors. But anyway, we use this term and because there are certain things that are similar for this group, and the first, of course, is that they're separated from parents and family, which is traumatic in itself. But they're also, if you look at the literature, they are more traumatized compared to minors that are accompanied or native-born children. And if looking at the literature, this is the figures that come up. On average, 3 to 6 stressful life events. This is a highly traumatized group of individuals in general. The mental health of these youngsters has been studied increasingly, I'd say, with more cross-sectional studies in different countries, mainly using questionnaires, which is, of course, not saying the same as giving them a diagnosis. This is just questionnaires. But they tend to indicate a pretty high psychiatric morbidity, though this, as you see, the figures are shifting from study to study. Again, it's hard to generalize, but between 20 and 55% with psychiatric morbidity from these type of studies. But then there is a good Norwegian study that was done by Jacobson and her colleagues, and they used structured clinical interviews on 160 unaccompanied minors 4 months after arrival to Norway. And what they found was that 42% of them had a psychiatric diagnosis, 42%. PTSD was most common, about 30%. Next to that was depression and then anxiety. There was no figures on comorbidity in this study, but and that's a bit unfortunate. And sleeping problem is, of course, with that kind of traumatic background, you it would be very surprising if there was no sleeping problems. So this is really, really, really common. Less is known about other mental health problems in this group of minors, including drug abuse, complex PTSD, etc. But there's no reason to expect that they would have less of that just because they're refugees. Of course, they can have ADHD, whatever, just as any other child. But this is, of course, the most typical problems that we see. What happens in the long run for these children, we don't know that much, but there has been a few quantitative follow-up studies up to 2 years after arrival. And on group level, they all show that the mental health problems tend to remain on group level. And baseline psychopathology, aggregated trauma burden and daily stressors are important predictors for the mental health development. And this is also, fits very well with other research on PTSD, that this, the situation here and now is also important. And that is, in a sense, sort of hopeful, I'd say, because that means that there's something we can do. They're not destined by their traumas. And yes, and the literature again indicates that these daily stresses may be more related to depressive symptoms, whereas trauma experience would be more related to PTSD. This is not really surprising. Late onset PTSD, yes, there has been a study on this, and they showed, I think it was like 20% or so, having PTSD like 2 years after arrival. So this is also one track that one might expect. There are different patterns, of course. So what are these daily stressors? There was this study by Verblier and colleagues in Belgium, and they investigated 103 unaccompanied minors. And this list will not surprise you, but difficulties obtaining legal residence, documents, uncertain future, am I going to be sent back to the country where I've fled from? Some children, of course, have contact with their with their family back home, and if they worry about the family, what are their conditions, what's happening to them? Insufficient food, clothing, money, housing, insufficient medical care. So a number of stressors, and the sad part, I guess, was that from this study, the stressors seemed to increase as they were here. What other factors can help us, know who will develop psychiatric problems in this particular group? Age and country of origin, we don't really know from the data, I would say. There's some indications that some, children from Somalia, I've read that they have actually been maybe more resilient than children from other countries, but this is very speculative. Does it matter what type of housing they stay in when they come to one of our countries? Maybe there are some indications that family foster care families is a better place than these other houses, housing types. But again, I think that's tricky. In Sweden, like now when we have had this huge influx, the social services haven't been able to control these families properly. So some children have been placed in families that were apparently not suitable for the job of caring for a child like this. Are the parents traumatized? Then that's a risk factor. Female sex is a risk factor. Social support is in the host country is protective, as well as positive school experience, and the opposite, of course, if that does not exist. So speaking about resilience and vulnerability, I think this is not far from rocket science, but it's important to remember that refugee status is not, or being a refugee, applying for asylum is not, doesn't mean that you have a psychiatric diagnosis, neither is being unaccompanied, despite the high risks. The patients that I see, they are actually the ones who have most psychiatric problems, often complex PTSD, comorbidity, etc. But even in this group, I think that we see a lot of strength and resilience, despite them having all the problems. So this is, I think, this is not mutually exclusive. I mean, you can have the have a lot of problems, but still have a sense of resilience. And the question is then if there is some kind of pre-flight selection, who is actually coming to Europe? I think it's fair to think that often it's not just the decision of the child to leave the home country or not. Usually there is some kind of adult involved in that process. And maybe they, you know, if you're sending a child across half the globe through all the hardships that they one would expect, maybe you don't choose those who are most vulnerable. That is not to say that women should be more vulnerable than men. I think that's that difference is probably for a different reason, and I guess culturally related. And talking about the resilience, it's interesting because there was a study in Sweden. They looked at the labor market and found that unaccompanied minors actually tend to perform better on the labor market compared to accompanied children. And that is a bit interesting. And again, pointing maybe to the resilience in this group. So, unmet mental health care needs, yes. I think that's, I don't know about Finland, but I think in Sweden it's fair to assume that there is a large unmet mental health care need. And this is also what you find in other studies. There was a Dutch study a couple of years ago where 60% of unaccompanied minors reported a mental health care need. 60% compared to 10% among Dutch adolescents. So a huge gap, right? But also the unaccompanied minors actually had more symptoms. Those unaccompanied minors who reported a need had more symptoms compared to the Dutch adolescents who reported a similar need. So they higher I don't know, what heter det? Tröskel, what heter det? Threshold, exactly, thank you. What was more worrying was that of those unaccompanied minors who reported a need, the adults in the network questioned about the healthcare of this child or the mental health problems. Only a third of the adults identified that the child had a problem. So this means, yes, there's probably a lot of internalizing symptoms that the adult network don't recognize. So in Sweden, we've done some studies on unaccompanied minors in terms of in and outpatient psychiatric care. I was involved in a study where we looked at inpatient care for unaccompanied minors in Skåne, the southern parts of Sweden, and how often they were admitted compared to other children. And we saw a clear overrepresentation of the unaccompanied minors. Then came another study looking at these young refugees, a bit older than the ones that we were looking at, and this was a register study, and what they found was that young refugees were overrepresented, but particularly the unaccompanied were overrepresented in inpatient and compulsory psychiatric care compared to the native population. So this discrepancy between both inpatient and outpatient care by young refugees suggests not only that there's a higher morbidity in this group, but also that there are different barriers to access healthcare, right? And what are these barriers? I mentioned the problem about the adult network not recognizing the problems, the psychiatric problems that the child might have. I think stigma on behalf of the minor is apparently an important risk for them not coming to the psychiatry. And I think that that's also my experience working clinically, that there's problems when it comes to stigma. Also, I mean, it's not just the network, but it's also some of these patients, of course, pass by other parts of the healthcare sector, primary healthcare, the school healthcare, etc. And I think the knowledge about the health of unaccompanied minors is probably not as good as one would hope, meaning that they're not referring these children enough. I think we also hear and come across attitudes in different sectors of society, including the psychiatric sector, that, well, yes, these youngsters are traumatized, but so no wonder that they're not doing so well. This is natural, and so they should also heal naturally, in a sense. And that's I mean, no, we shouldn't medicalize these minors if not needed, but that's a really strange argument. That's like saying, well, if you fall from the third floor and you break your leg, you shouldn't have any medical attention for that, because it's natural that you break your leg. You don't need a cast, you don't need treatment. But also that we have we hear ideas like, well, they're still in asylum, they don't have right to access healthcare, etc. So this is another hurdle. And then last, it's just looking at the sheer numbers of unaccompanied minors in Sweden, I think this is a barrier in itself. Going back to the figures that I mentioned earlier, this study from Norway, if 42% of the unaccompanied minors coming to Sweden have a psychiatric diagnosis, that means that 14,500 unaccompanied minors should, as a minimum, be assessed by the psychiatric service, I think. I mean, they could have a depression, PTSD, anxiety, whatever. They need to be assessed properly. And there's no way that they are going to be assessed, because we don't have the resources. So just the sheer numbers is a problem. So what type of treatment should we then offer them? This is a researcher from Austria, Julia Schumer, and she wrote in The Lancet 2009, she said that interventions for unaccompanied minors need to be multimodal and culturally sensitive, not surprising. And this group does not fit traditional parameters for refugee children or young people in care. And I would agree with her. I think, and of course, not every unaccompanied minor needs a very highly specialized psychiatric service, but some certainly do. And the healthcare needs to organize itself accordingly. So now to more clinical aspect then. Yes, I don't know if... what do you think is difficult about assessing unaccompanied minors? You meet them clinically too, I suppose. Anyone? Okay, I move forward. The most obvious is, of course, that as a psychiatrist, you lack important information to assess a child. Without the parents to help you, you don't have any information on the attachment pattern, which is crucial. We don't know anything really about their development, motorically, language, socially, etc. We don't know anything often about the heredity. Do they have family members with any other psychiatric disease? We have the problem of language, culture, stigma that we have to bypass or try to bypass somehow. We have the avoidance, like in any other person with PTSD or post-traumatic symptoms, so they don't want to speak about this. My experience is that often, maybe this is reflecting the trauma avoidance, but often they're very focused on the situation here and now. I'm not happy about my housing, the asylum process, what's going to happen, etc. What about school? When can I start school? Different practical issues here and now that certainly affects them, and that they want to speak about. They come from a chaotic background. They've been traumatized in the home country, maybe during the journey. And I think the timeline, so to speak, is, and the course of the symptoms is often blurred for these individuals. They can't. When if I ask them, when did you start having sleep problems? It's not that easy for them. Sometimes they say, well, it started when I came to Sweden. And that might be true, actually. I mean, you know, they haven't been thinking about it. Their whole being has been focused on survival, getting to this place. So if they don't sleep, that hasn't been a big problem. But when they come to some sort of safety, they start noticing that the sleep is not very well. The level of functioning, who can tell us about how they're functioning? We have to rely on then maybe the legal guardian, maybe some of the staff at their the housing where they're staying. But this is difficult to get a good picture. And sometimes the housing don't communicate with the school, so the housing don't know if the child actually goes to school or not. They just, in the afternoon, they open the door, wow, you're still here. You know, they didn't know that the child was supposed to go, didn't go to school that day. So this is problematic. And yes, so reliable information from the guardian and the housing staff, it's not always that you can get that. Yes, and so with this difficulties, it also becomes difficult to assess differential diagnose comorbidity, I'd say. Well, it worked. Okay. And this is maybe very basic to you. I think it's, but I'll go through them anyway. What to think about when you assess these minors. A warm, empathetic, and curious approach. Very good start. We always try to explain very clearly for the child the context. Where have you come? Why are you here? What do we know about you from the referral? And what kind of help we possibly could offer? And we spend a lot of time making sure the patient knows that I will ask questions. I will ask questions about the trauma, and I will ask difficult questions. But it's the child who decides if he or she is going to answer or not. So you give the power and the agency to the child. Matt, you were touching on that, but we this process of normalizing that they often they don't know why they behave or that why they have these problems. But we, you know, a good start is just to explain that you've experienced extremely difficulties, extreme traumas, and it's normal to react with different symptoms after a trauma like that. So it's nothing wrong with you. The problem is the things that you've exposed to. And I think also this is a really dry spot for these unaccompanied minors to be validated. You can never validate enough, and doing that, I think, just in itself makes a huge difference. You know, sometimes these patients, they say, if I'm doing a good job, they say, you're the first one who understands me. And they say, keep validating until you get the head nod. You know, you say, that's terrible. And then they keep explaining, blah, 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 I haven't understood it. Oh, that must be, I can really understand that when you this happened to you, that you're feeling so bad, etc. And so you validate until you get the head nod. You know, the patient feels that he's understood or she's understood. We work or try to work hard to gather information from the adult network. I mentioned they're not always reliable, but it's the only external source that we have, so we have to use them. So we try to make phone calls, to have them come into the clinic, etc. In the assessment, you can do different, all kinds of diagnostic, use different diagnostic tools, but as a minimum, I think a systematic trauma exposure questionnaire and a systematic trauma symptom scale is a minimum. And then you have to do another, probably a lot more, but this should be a minimum, and I think it should be for every child. Any unaccompanied minors coming to psychiatry. Physical examination is a good thing to do. I think it helps the alliance with the patient, and also sometimes when you do the clinical or physical examination, you see scars that they wouldn't tell you about. You might find out that they've been tortured that they didn't tell you. So doing a physical examination is also mandatory, I'd say, in this group of children, if they're self-harming, etc. The cultural formulation interview, I'm not using that very regularly, but I use it sometimes when we have troubles, sorting out and the treatment doesn't work. It might be useful to add on. I talked earlier on the symptoms being blurred and what happened here, what happened then, when did I develop the symptoms, etc. So using a lifeline or timeline just to register, for the child, make it very graphic. Okay, this happened then, and then this happened, and when did you develop these symptoms? It can sort of help the child and the clinician to get a better overview of what happened and when the symptoms developed. You have to work often on treatment motivation. They say, can you give me a pill so I can forget all the things that I've experienced? So working on the treatment motivation and give them a sense of agency is very important, I think. Just something about the physical health then. Some of these, in the adolescence, they can have secondary enuresis. And this is very shameful. I had one boy from Afghanistan. He was 15 years of age. He started every morning taking his sheets down to the washing room, hiding it, putting on new sheets. So it's good to ask questions about this, because this happens. Some of them have vitamin D deficiency. I don't think there's much effect on the treating the deficiency, but I don't know your experience, but I sometimes check this and I treat it if it's low. Infection, anemia. Yeah. So the level of interventions, I think, considering the extent of post-traumatic symptoms in this group and just in Sweden the share numbers, it's impossible for us to help all of them in the specialized psychiatric care, but everyone needs help with these basic things. Yeah. then if the first level of interventions is not enough, I think it's fair to, you know, start engaging the network, maybe do some psychoeducation. If that doesn't help, maybe move on to psychotherapy, possibly sleep medication, and then as a fourth level, maybe more specialized treatment like the unit where I'm working, where we have treating those who are doing worst. So this is the unit, Unit for War and Torture Victims in Malmö, and we actually also have the possibility sometimes to offer, if this is not just an unaccompanied minor, but an accompanied minors, we sometimes are able to treat the parent at the same unit, and that's very helpful. We offer psychoeducation, of course, skills training, affect modulation, and often this is done in group, particularly now because we have a waiting list of 1 year, which is terrible. So this is some kind of band-aid for our own deficiencies. We offer this psychoeducation in group, and I think we haven't been studying it, but I think clinically, we see a pretty good effect of this. Doesn't fit everybody, of course. Then we offer also individual psychotherapy. Sometimes this is done in group, but more often individually. We have a physiotherapist who is also doing good work with different kind of physiotherapist intervention. I don't know the English word for it, basal kroppskännedom, but and some yoga interventions. We have some dancing interventions, swimming, etc. So that can be actually quite helpful. And we're also fortunate to have a person working with us who's a coordinator, and we have social workers, and they work primarily with these more practical aspects of the situation for unaccompanied minors. Amongst other things, we talked about that over the lunch, but when they go to the interview at the migration board, this can be, you know, of course, a re-traumatizing event. And sometimes they follow them to this interview at the migration board. We work a lot with network meeting. I think I mentioned that a couple of times now, but working on the network, you can't overestimate the effect of this, because that is addressing some of the basic roots to the problems that they experience, that there's no sense of coherence. And just physically sitting in a room with the therapist, the doctor, the legal guardian, someone from the housing, you know, in the same room, and we're all here, and we want to help you. That is quite effectful, really. We try to use the same interpreter for all the sessions, so they feel more comfortable. Sometimes we also write certificates for the migration authority to document their psychiatric morbidity. I could spend the whole week really writing these type of documents. But I think it actually is part of the treatment, because it's fair enough. We describe their psychiatric problems. If that can help them in the asylum process, that's fine. As long as you stick to the truth, of course. But also it helps, you know, the child to install some kind of hope, sometimes realistic hope. And then psychotherapy. Yes, trauma-focused CBT is obviously the most evidence-based psychotherapeutic method for PTSD in minors. We also do some EMDR therapy, though this is not so well researched, but we have some psychologists who does that. And all trauma treatment is really, of course, we face specific. So with this psychoeducation, stabilization, trauma exposure, consolidation, and back and forth in these different modes of treatment. And TF-CBT probably has some effect on secondary depression. Of course, it was actually developed in order to address depression in minors. Our experience, I'm not a psychotherapist myself, but my colleagues repeat that exposure therapy is also possible during the asylum process. And this is probably controversial to many of you, and I heard Mats, you were referring to this patient, this person from Syria, who'd been told that we can't do psychotherapy while you're too unstable. And of course, if you're not stable enough, you can't do it. But there are often many things you can do to help them reach a level of stabilization, so you can offer the exposure therapy. Many of our patients have complex PTSD, so that means we use much longer time on the stabilization phase before moving into exposure therapy. And the treatment duration, I don't know. I think because we often start during the asylum process, and these, I think, I don't have the figures here, but I would say most of our patients are in treatment for at least 1 year. Sleep. Some of you might be sleeping now, but we know that disturbed sleep can contribute to the development of PTSD and other psychopathologies secondary to trauma exposure. It can also, sleep problems can also maintain and exacerbate PTSD. And also, there was a quite recent article here. They were describing how it also might interfere, sleep problem might interfere with the extinction learning and emotional processes. So sleep is a very good start for intervention, and also a thing where we actually can do something, not just therapeutically, but also pharmacologically. Treating insomnia and nightmares. Start with sleep hygiene, relaxation, breathing exercises. I don't know about you, but these breathing exercises, I think it's kind of, it's not so such a sexy research subject, but I came across a couple of articles about this recently, and it's pretty effective. That was new to me. Not that it works, but that there was actually evidence to back it up. Some of our therapists offer imagery rehearsal therapy, which can also be helpful. CBT insomnia, which is a modification of CBT focused on insomnia. And there's no, I don't know any study on this intervention on refugee minors, but on other PTSD patients and other group of youngsters, this has been affected both individually and actually in group. So that's a promising area of intervention. And then we have the pharmacology. I don't know, are there any doctors in here? Okay, so this is for you then. I don't know. It's not that much to say, really. The first level, I usually start with melatonin, which is a substance which the brain produces in itself. To help regulate the rhythm, the circadian rhythm, and little side effects. So I actually start with melatonin if I do some medication. But I'll move on to the next level then, because that's maybe more interesting. I don't know if you're using any of that with the prasosin. which is or there's also similar substances, guanfacine and clonidine. They're not really the same, but they're in the relatives, one could say. But prazosin is a promising mode of intervention, actually. It's a centrally acting alpha-1 adrenerg receptor antagonist, if that makes any one of you more happy to hear. And it was approved a long time ago for treating hypertension. But now we know that it also, well, not also, we knew that before, but it reduces sympathetic activity in the brain. And there's been quite a few RCT, randomized control studies, on adults showing good effects on PTSD-related nightmares, but also sleep in general and hyperarousal. There are a few studies or case studies on children, so not much there, but these case studies are positive. And there was just a review a few weeks ago published on these case studies. So it's kind of promising. There are some side effects with dizziness, blurred vision, vertigo, etc. But this is very... It may be difficult for you to see. If I point there, it doesn't help you if I point here. But this is... So this is being alert, but safe. And here you have the... This is where the norepinephrine is released. It's called nucleus ceruleus. And it releases... norepinephrine to different parts of the brain, helping the prefrontal cortex to regulate other parts of the brain, like the amygdala. And the amygdala, you know, is part of the limbic system, where our emotions and stimuli to threat is controlled. It's from the amygdala. So if you have a prefrontal cortex which is functioning properly, then you have better options to control the amygdala and your reactions to perceived threats, basically. You can control it. What happens if you're overstressed or if you have in the PTSD situation, the prefrontal cortex is not working so well. And there's a huge amount of norepinephrinic weakening the prefrontal cortex and weakening its possibility to control the amygdala. And here is where this prazosin comes in, because it can block here and here so that prefrontal cortex works slightly better, helping you to control nightmares and emotional reactions to threat. Okay. Other psychopharmacological interventions. There's no approved medication for PTSD in children. But there's still some things we can do for specific symptoms. I just spoke about sleep. SSRI, that's approved for PTSD in adults, and sometimes I use it for these minors when they become 17, 18. But the effect is not that impressive, really. Not impressive at all, really. But specifically, if they have a comorbid depression or comorbid anxiety disorder, that's possible. Antipsychotic medication, of course, should be really cautious about using this, but we use it sometimes, especially for those minors that are admitted to the inpatient ward, when they're very violent, they have very much dissociative or psychosis-like symptoms. Then these is worthwhile considering. And I think of course, this is you do with that with all every patient. You have to use a lot of time to explain why you have you want to use the medication, but particularly in this group of patients, they might have many worries and ideas about medication that you can just by speaking to them make them more think this is might be a good idea. And communication with the housing staff, because they are the ones who are, if you decide to use a medication, this is, you know, I wouldn't want a 15-year-old boy from Afghanistan to with suicidal thoughts and self-harming behavior to deal with his medication on his own, right? So you want the staff at the housing to take care of this. And I don't know how many times I've had problems with this. Often it just doesn't work. You know, they get the medication completely wrong. I give them sleep medication, 3 tablets at night, and they come back, and I hear they get them in the morning for lunch and for the afternoon. So this is an important task. You have to put a lot of effort into making this work, because and if you don't put that effort, you can be sure it doesn't work. Just some treatment challenges. Approaching trauma too fast or without proper sensitivity. You sit there with a patient and you start asking about traumas and you think it goes, oh, this goes pretty well. And all of a sudden they react and you have to... A couple of times I've had to walk with the patients around the block, you know, and come back and, you know, bring them down again. So you have to be, I mean, this is the balance, right? And this is the clinical experience, really. When can you ask, how can you ask, and when are you asking too much? When do you have to pull back? But the other problem is equally problematic, I think, moving too slow. I jumped one there, but yeah, we also have patients who've been in therapy for 1 year and there hasn't been any trauma exposure therapy at all. That's equally problematic. If there is too much instability, you can do other interventions, but you can't do maybe trauma focused interventions. Emotional overload on the therapist, that's also a challenge. We've had a couple of colleagues who've been on sick leave, so we spend a lot of time in groups talking about the patients, having a schedule with a number of patients that is, you know, make it reasonable so you can continue doing this work. You need to take care of yourself. Kirsti, I think we spoke about your study. I think this problem with many of these children, of course, they move, you know, from one place to another. So that makes also makes for a problem in terms of continuity. You lose your patients. And what happens after someone is granted asylum? They want to move forward. They're not, you know, you've spent a year trying to motivate to get them to come to therapy and they've done it, and then when you're about to start, maybe they get asylum, everyone is happy, but that also means that they sometimes drop out of therapy. I have some slides about the emergency unit, because I don't know in Finland, but in Sweden we see them quite often at the child psychiatric emergency unit. And they come there often in relation to a negative decision in the asylum process, and they become violent, they go berserk at house, back home, self-harming, suicidal threats, suicidal behavior. And they are in crisis, hopeless, desperate, and this is also a problem for the doctor and the other staff at the emergency unit. How they sometimes become very emotionally affected, just as we all do, but they're maybe less experienced with this, but they feel the same hopelessness and what to do. What to do? And the housing staff that brings the child to the emergency unit, they're often very scared by the behavior, and they say, ho, no, we can't take Reza back. It's too dangerous. And should Reza then be admitted to the psychiatric ward just because the personnel doesn't want to have him or her back? I don't know. But this is a problem. And the thing to do is, of course, contain again, bring in the network, call the legal guardian, call housing staff, and we also sometimes do this network map. I don't know if that's anything is new to you, but I talked about the network meeting when you have the person in all the persons in the room, which is more effective. But sometimes this a map like this, with the patient in the center, and then all the persons in his network that usually more or less try to help the child. So you have maybe you have a contact person at where you live that you have a good connection with. The guardian, how is your connection to the guardian? Is he or she helpful? Can we engage that person more to help you? Maybe you're already in therapy. He or she is helping you. You have the teacher. Maybe the teacher. Some of them have developed good relations with the teacher. Friends, leisure activity. Do you have friends at the football? Lawyer. To illustrate that they're not alone. Basically. And if it's possible, can you install some realistic hope? Sometimes when they come to the emergency, we tell them, well, this is, I hear you've got a negative decision in your asylum process, but if you want to, I can write a document about your mental health problems. Again, this is not the solution to Reza, but it might give him some kind of hope that this will help him in the process. Can you add some anxiolytic or sleep medication to help him or her get over this crisis? Have them offer them a quick follow-up at the outpatient unit. If all of this doesn't work, then maybe you have to admit them to the hospital, and we do. We have a couple of, out of 10 or 12 beds, we have maybe often 2, 3, 4 unaccompanied minors at the inpatient ward. And this is not obvious. I mean, at least a couple of years ago in Sweden, this was a big debate. Other child psychiatric inpatient wards didn't want to admit them because they were asylum seekers, all kinds of arguments for not admitting them. And when they are admitted, then again, sometimes this debate starts again. Why are they here? Can we? This is. We shouldn't medicalize. Blah blah blah. You have all this discussion. So it's a problem. I will mention something about this mobile first aid unit that we started at my clinic. We started 2016 as a result of this big influx of refugees to Sweden, and how can we deal with this? So this was a project with one psychologist, one social worker, and one car. And they have been driving around all through Skåne, visiting different asylum centers, housing centers, etc., doing psychoeducation and coping strategies directly as a primary, or maybe you would rather call it secondary intervention because they're already traumatized. But And by now they've reached 500 individuals. And the hope was, of course, that this could, you know, prevent, help some of the children not, to do better, basically. And we don't know if they are doing better, how this is, if this is helping and how. We don't know. But the preliminary evaluations has been positive. The children think this is good. Okay, I have some slides here at the end. I didn't know if I would have time, but I just to mention something about sometimes people question the whole idea of PTSD, right? I've mentioned it before, like this is natural, blah blah blah, but this is not something that we have invented in this field of psychiatry. Though there is little objective findings, but there are some, and what we know is, of course, that there's an increased catecholamine activity. This can be measured in different ways, but we know that this is increased, referring to the brain there that I showed before. We know that the cortisol level is dysregulated. The findings have been some mixed results, different on adults, different on adolescents. But it seems quite clear that cortisol is dysregulated, and there are some hypotheses that cortisol in itself is toxic for the in high levels, affecting the brain, the nerve cells. We know that childhood abuse and neglect result in shorter length of telomere at the DNA level, and the telomere. Shorter telomere length equals, or the length of the telomere is a sign of biological age. So with a shorter telomere, that means that you're biologically older. And this is what you find when you look at traumatized, maltreated children, no matter diagnose. We know that it's also connected to metabolic syndrome, ischemic heart disease, cancer, and inflammation in adulthood. So this is not just a psychiatric disease, really. It's also have many other consequences. And now we're back at the brain again. I'm happy for that. And this is to show you some of the areas that are affected. If you do fMRI or MRI studies, on group level, you see changes here in the prefrontal cortex. Some findings indicate that this is a structural problem or structural changes in the cortex, but also a change in function. So the prefrontal cortex helps us control, plan. Concentrate, but this doesn't work, it can explain why it's difficult concentrating, for instance, and planning. Difficult is regulating your emotions. The amygdala, which is part of the limbic system, is also there's some again different findings, but on and also sometimes relating to age. But some have found that this is, at least in adult patients with PTSD, that this is affected also in children. And this is a structure that is highly, there are high levels of glucocorticoid receptors. So if you have high levels of cortisol, it's not surprising that this structure would be affected. And we know functionally it doesn't work as it should. People with PTSD react much stronger at perceived threats compared to control groups. And then you have the hippocampus, where we retrieve memories. And this is also both structurally and functionally changed in children that are maltreated. And then you have this sector here, which is called the corpus callosum, which is where they've also found changes in this area of the brain. And this is a structure that helps the two brain halves communicate. Yes, and the question then is this... well, okay, I can continue here. Just is this specific to PTSD or maltreatment? No, it's not, because they find this similar findings in children with different psychopathology. So there's been a debate that, well, is this due to depression, you know, or is it due to PTSD, blah, blah, blah. And it seems like the reason why these changes are found across different diagnoses is due to maltreatment. So if you look at, if they've found changes in a brain structure in patients with depression, if you look closer and you see that, well, these children might actually have been maltreated, but they didn't ask for maltreatment in the study. So this might actually be a confounder. So the changes might be due to maltreatment rather than connected to specific diagnosis. And there is some evidence that maltreated and non-maltreatment patients with the same diagnosis differ neurobiologically and clinically. And that is, you know, a depression with a patient with depression who has been maltreated responds differently to interventions like pharmacology. And that is kind of interesting. But then also, one might ask, is this adaptions, these changes in the brain that we find after maltreatment and abuse, is that like a consequence, or is it an adoption to a threatful environment? And it might actually be that this is, you know, it helps, it's an evolutionary helpful to develop these kind of changes if you live in an environment full of threats. It's probably better to react one time too much rather than one time too little, right? And then also, but you also find some of these changes in the brain in patients without psychopathology, which is interesting. So why? Why is that? And do they, why don't they develop psychopathology despite the fact that they have changes in the brain? So is there some kind of coping mechanism that we can't see on these brain scans or whatever? But it's an interesting question. Yes. So to summarize, I'd say unaccompanied minors are a vulnerable group with vast psychiatric morbidity, and this does not exclude that they also at the same time are resilient on some level. There's probably a large unmet mental health care need in this group, and asylum process does not prevent trauma exposure therapy as such. Engage in the network of adults if you're dealing with these youngsters. Validate, contain, and motivate for treatment. And if you want to use any medication, focus, I think, primarily on sleep. And last, take care of yourself, because you need, if you're dealing with these youngsters, and you can do a big difference. And I just want to finish off with where I started, Blood on the Tracks. Again, Bob Dylan, I'm living in a foreign country, but I'm bound to cross the line. beauty walks on razor's edge, someday I'll make it mine. So I guess that could be a mission for us, to make beauty walk on razor's edge. Thank you.
So, thank you a lot, Björn. Then I'm sure you guys have tons of questions. Yes, excellent.
Hi, thank you very much for the lecture. It's not necessarily a question, but a comment, because we've been walking in a acute psychiatric ward for adults that basically takes care in the Helsinki region of asylum seekers that are still in the process of getting the refugee status. And we've actually have experienced the same problems and the same issues with mostly young adults that are admitted to the ward. And the whole lecture, we've been just nodding our heads that, yeah, this is exactly the same thing that we deal with on everyday basis. So we've been a little bit also wondering whether it's just that adults, but in crisis, regress to the level of an adolescent, or is it just that we, like, in a way Mads mentioned, that we underestimate our patients in a way that maybe they would cope better, but we... in a way, we regress them to that level, but that's maybe adult psychiatry questions. Yeah, but this, we've been nodding our heads all lecture long.
Yeah. Well, so how do you deal with them? What do you do?
I guess we do all the same things. We unfortunately have less group activities. So, and because of the specificity of the ward in general, and not that it's not focused solely on treating the asylum seekers. We have lots of other things going on, so we just do the very best we can, but most of it follows what you've been talking about.
Yeah, but who wouldn't regress in a crisis? You know, I think you mentioned this is a big, important issue, how to deal with those patients. But I think I would my answer would be that it's more common that we, you know, don't sort of accept their regression in a way that we should. I mean, this is probably temporarily a regression. So in that situation, it might be a really good idea to admit them for inpatient care, I think. Of course, not always, but I think it's more common that we sort of have them not admitted than we should. That's my experience.
I guess ours is similar. Thank you.
Yes, thanks for a good question. Something else on your mind? Yes, Sato Prince, you have the microphone.
Yes, just a short one. You talked about sleep and insomnia. Yeah. And my colleagues in Integrationsnet, they use music therapy quite a bit as treatment for insomnia, and allegedly with good results, or so they say. Do you have any experience with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's part of the sleep hygiene intervention. I mean, if the patient thinks experiences that he's helped or she's helped by music, then that happens. I've heard that, but I've also heard that some patients, when they listen to the music, they actually become more sad. You know, they have music from their home country maybe, and they think they're going to get some comfort out of that, and maybe sometimes they do. At other times, the same music might give them more sense of sorrow, loss. I think it's worthwhile exploring if music can be helpful for the individual patient. Certainly,
Yes.
And then Päivi, go ahead.
Thank you very much for the very encouraging lecture. And I'm a child psychiatrist myself. And what I'm thinking, like, you have 10 times more unaccompanied minors than we do in Finland. So you have 10 times more to do the work. But I think still in Finland we have the trouble that we don't get adolescent to treatment. And you said that you have 1 year queue. And what I have worked with adolescents is that it's often long time before you get person to the queue. You have to first negotiate with the adolescent, and then you have to negotiate with somebody to make the referral. So it's very long way before they are in your office. So I think, well, that's just my idea, and I don't know. I'm interested to hear your opinion. But I think we really have to get things we can, like you told about the ambulance, that things...
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, first aid, moving around, that we go to the housing places and we go around so that we can skip this negotiation, who is writing the referral, or writing the referral, it's accepted queuing to get more quick aid and for the bigger numbers of adolescents. Well, I have also, I'm a psychiatrist, but I have also background in public health. Mm-hmm. So I think that we should... very much also we psychiatrists should tell and help and find the means to support mental health in everyday surroundings. But of course, the trauma treatment is important, but how we could make it quicker.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is really an organizational challenge, right? And also, what could we offer on a larger scale, and what evidence do we have to offer a different kind of treatments in larger scale? And I know there have been some studies also looking into school-based intervention. And I think the results haven't been all that promising. But I think school-based interventions, I think, is a potential for reaching a much larger group of individuals. But then again, I think what we do at my team, in order to achieve what you're implying, I think, I mean, because you have to have the knowledge at the teachers, the school doctor, at the housing staff. So we are doing an enormous amount of teaching to this group. We have education for the housing staff. We have for the school, we have for our colleagues at the child and adolescent psychiatry, because on all these levels, I think it's much better now than it was 5 years ago, but there's still a huge need. Tomorrow we have a teaching for housing staff. There are 300 adults registered for this course.
Comment that next time we invite you to tell about these things. Because I think we the world goes on, and we will have still refugees after 2015 also in the large amounts. Yeah. So
thank you.
Okay. Something else, or should we head? Yes, one more.
I'm working here in Paloma Project, but one of my professions are occupational therapists. I'm very interested in assessment and assessment equipment. So my question is that, do you have OT on your working group in Sweden? And how much are they doing the assessments? Because I know the activities and the volume of power of them. Yeah.
At my team, we don't have an occupational therapist, but we do at the same time, because she's a psychologist, used to be an occupational therapist, but she's not particularly part of the assessment, and I couldn't answer to how much she's using her competence as an occupational therapist in the treatment. But I know there are at least at the
rehabilitation unit, of course, we have occupational therapists. I think I'll stop there.
All right, so thanks for the good questions, and once again, thank you.
Thank you.
Here you go. So that you don't forget us.